Welcome to Adult Sleep Stories. Finding moments of peace in the hustle and bustle of our lives can be a bit challenging. Our channel is your sanctuary, a place where captivating tales blend with soothing tones, guiding you toward restful slumber. Escape from the noise, let go of the day's stresses, and allow our stories to transport you to realms of tranquility and dreams. Whether you're seeking relaxation, meditation, or simply a good night's sleep, you're in the right place. So, settle in, close your eyes, and let the journey to serenity begin. In our unceasing journey through the corridors of life, moments of pure, unadulterated tranquility can sometimes seem as elusive as shadows at noon. The modern world is a symphony of endless noises, from the incessant hum of digital screens to the ceaseless whispers of obligations, commitments, and desires. In this symphony, our souls often search for a gentle lullaby, a melodious escape, a chance to pause, breathe, and simply be. Now, as you find yourself here in the magic of this narrative oasis, know that you've stumbled upon a sanctuary, a world where serenity isn't just a luxury, but a promise. Picture, if you will, a secluded haven nestled amidst nature's embrace, where the wind hums lullabies, and time itself seems to tread lightly. This is where we invite you to journey with us, a place of meditation, reflection, and utter calm. Begin by taking a deep, resolute breath. Feel the cool air grace your nostrils, traveling through the depths of your lungs, filling your being with the ancient rhythms of existence. And then, as you exhale, imagine releasing the shackles of worry, stress, and the relentless march of time. Each subsequent breath is a step deeper into the heart of tranquility, a dance with the universe, an affirmation of the present moment. We live in an era where the very essence of our existence often feels fragmented. Pulled in myriad directions by demands, expectations, and the invisible threads of technology, it's easy to lose oneself. But these tales, each a gem sculpted from the rich tapestries of imagination and insight, seek to offer you a bridge. A bridge not just to sleep, but that in itself is a cherished realm of restoration, but to a state of soulful relaxation, where the world narrows down to the here and now, where every heartbeat is a reminder of life's simple beauties. These stories are not just words. They are portals. They beckon you into worlds where the pace is gentler, the colors more vivid, and the sounds harmoniously aligned with the rhythms of the cosmos. Here, amidst these tales, you'll find characters and landscapes that resonate with the deepest parts of your psyche, invoking a sense of familiarity and nostalgia. They're like old friends or forgotten dreams, waiting to welcome you back. As you immerse yourself in these narratives, let the outside world fade into soft focus. Envision your stresses and anxieties as leaves carried away by a gentle stream, disappearing beyond the horizon. Let the weight of expectation, the clamor of responsibilities, and the noise of uncertainty be replaced by the soothing cadences of these stories. Every word, every phrase, is a brushstroke painting a world of peace, inviting you to step in and explore. Sleep, that precious gift, is not just a physical necessity but a balm for the soul. It's nature's way of healing, restoring, and rejuvenating. As you stand at the threshold of dreams, these tales are the gentle hands guiding you towards restful slumber. They remind you of the beauty of surrender, of letting go, of drifting into the comforting embrace of night. So, dear listener, as you embark on this journey with us, know that you are not alone. Through the magic of these tales, we are with you, sharing in your quest for tranquility and deep, restorative sleep. Let these stories be your anchor, your lighthouse, guiding you away from the tempests of daily life and into the calm waters of relaxation and dreams. Welcome to our sanctuary. Let the journey to serenity begin. The Mystery of the Underworld of Atlantis. Chapter 1. The Sunken Echoes. Dr. Morgan Shaw had always been captivated by the sea, the way it concealed its secrets beneath undulating waves and how it whispered tales of lost civilizations in every shell and grain of sand. But nothing in her extensive career as a marine archaeologist had prepared her for the discovery that lay just beyond the reach of her dive light in the murky depths off the coast of Crete. She first heard the echo of Atlantis in a musty, forgotten corner of the Alexandria Library. An ancient text, bound in salt-stained leather, spoke of a land beneath the waves, a city of wisdom where the sea itself granted its blessing upon the people. The Atlantis in these pages wasn't just a city, it was a beacon of civilization, a nexus of knowledge and culture that had attracted scholars from across the ancient world. But it was the cryptic tablets, etched with a language that seemed to dance away from comprehension, which had set her on this journey. Her discovery of these tablets, half buried in the ocean floor, had been an accident, a chance deviation from her planned dive path when a curious octopus had caught her eye. But as she brushed away centuries of sediment, revealing the intricate inscriptions, she knew destiny had played its hand. The tablets were a map, but not one that charted any seas she had sailed before. Instead, they hinted at the existence of a subterranean passage, a gateway to a world beneath the world, where the last echoes of Atlantis might still live. Preparation for the dive was meticulous. The cave, detected by sonar after months of fruitless searching, was located nearly a mile beneath the surface. It was a treacherous descent through jagged rocks and into the abyssal plains of the ocean. Morgan's team was small, a trio of researchers as doggedly determined as she was, and each one was a veteran of the deep. They descended in submersibles, equipped with the latest technology. Each craft was a tiny sphere of safety in the crushing dark, its exterior lights piercing the gloom. As they reached the ocean floor, a vast mouth of darkness greeted them, the entrance to the cave promised by the ancient tablets. The underwater cave was a gaping maw in the side of an undersea cliff. It yawned wide, the water within eerily still, a stark contrast to the gentle currents of the outer sea. The beams from their submersibles flickered across rock formations shaped by time and pressure, and as Morgan's craft edged forward, the light caught something that made her heart skip, a perfectly circular archway, carved not by water, but by human hands. Exiting the submersible in her dive gear, Morgan felt the familiar rush of adrenaline as the cold of the deep pressed against her suit. Her hands moved methodically, checking her oxygen supply and the integrity of her equipment. The beam of her torch cut through the darkness, revealing a tunnel that sloped upward, angling toward the heart of the island above. The team progressed slowly, tethered to their subs by lifelines, as they swam through the ancient passage. Here and there, carvings emerged from the rock, stylized waves, tridents, and depictions of a city bathed in light, scenes of Atlantis as it once might have been. Hours passed, the concept of time becoming as fluid as the water through which they swam. The tunnel opened into a cavern of immense size, where the water was so clear it was like swimming in the air. Stalactites and stalagmites framed the space, natural pillars that held the weight of centuries. Then, as they moved through the cathedral-like expanse, they found it, the first true relic of the Atlantean world. It was a statue, or what remained of it, a figure carved in a crystalline material that might have been quartz, now half covered in mineral deposits. The statue was androgynous, its features worn away, but its hands were raised as if in benediction or warning. They made camp on a small beach in the cavern, the lights of their equipment a stark contrast to the soft glow of bioluminescent algae that clung to the walls. It was here that Morgan took out the tablets once more, comparing the inscriptions to the carvings that adorned the cavern walls. The match was undeniable. The language of the tablets was here too, a guide written by the very people who had once walked these halls. And as the pieces of the ancient puzzle came together, a path emerged, leading deeper into the Atlantis that slumbered beneath the island of Crete. Sleep was a distant thought as Morgan traced the lines of the inscriptions with her fingers, her mind alight with possibilities. This was only the beginning of the labyrinth and depths that awaited them, of the secrets that lay hidden in the heart of the sea. As her team rested, equipment beeping softly in the background, Morgan took one last look at the statue. Its eyes seemed to catch the faintest glimmer of light, and for a moment, she could almost hear the thrum of the city that beat in time with the waves above. The echo of Atlantis was calling, and she was ready to delve into its forgotten depths. Chapter 2. The Labyrinth and Depths. Morgan Shaw's dreams had always been filled with the undulating rhythms of the sea. But that night, as she rested in the cavern's quietude, her dreams were invaded by visions of towering structures and waterways that bore the wisdom of a civilization long past. When she awoke, the pale glow of the bioluminescent algae seemed to beckon her deeper into the subterranean wonder. Breakfast was a quiet affair, each member of the team lost in their thoughts, sipping at the strong, black coffee they had brought with them to fend off the chill of the deep. They discussed their plan in hushed tones that echoed off the cavern walls. The path ahead was uncharted, and every step was a step into the unknown. Once they had stowed their gear, Morgan led the way. The passage they followed twisted and turned like the innards of some ancient beast. Here, the evidence of human artistry was even more pronounced, walls smooth to perfection, carvings that depicted scenes of life, markets, children at play, rulers in their regal attire. The team came across the first puzzle at a junction where three paths converged. A series of stone wheels, each carved with the Atlantean script, were set into the walls. They quickly realized that the wheels were a lock of sorts, one that required a precise alignment to open the way forward. Morgan turned to the tablets once more, her fingers tracing the lines of symbols that suddenly seemed to be a key to the lock before them. With a scholar's patience, she worked at the puzzle, aligning symbols with an ancient logic that felt almost intuitive. There was a moment of silence when the last wheel clicked into place, then a low rumble as the passage ahead slid open. They were greeted by a gush of air, a breath from the belly of the earth that carried with it the scent of something ancient and untouched. Their lights revealed a corridor lined with statues of Atlantean figures, each one holding aloft a source of light that still glowed with a faint, inexplicable power. The team moved with reverence, acutely aware that they were the first to walk these halls in millennia. As they progressed, the corridor widened and the air grew warmer. They emerged into a chamber so large that their lights couldn't find the far walls. It was here that they encountered the next marvel, a vast map of the stars carved into the chamber floor, with constellations that no longer graced the night sky. Morgan documented everything, her camera whirring softly in the stillness. As they crossed the chamber, her deputy, Alex, stumbled upon a series of levers embedded in the wall. It was another test, she realized, and the solution would reveal the path onward. The levers corresponded to the constellations, and as the team worked to match them with their positions on the map, the chamber began to transform. The floor split and moved, reconfiguring like a giant puzzle until it formed a bridge that spanned a chasm that opened in the earth beneath them. The bridge led to a door of iridescent metal that shimmered with an otherworldly hue, and it was only Morgan's steady hand that held back the eager hands of her colleagues. She took a moment to record the symbols that flanked the door, a historian's diligence mingling with an adventurer's fervor. The door opened to a passageway that sloped gently upward, and as they climbed, the air changed, grew fresher. They found themselves at the edge of an underground river, its waters clear and swift. A boat, fashioned from the same iridescent metal as the door, lay moored at a dock, as if waiting for them. Boarding the boat, they activated a mechanism that seemed to be powered by the river's current, and the craft began to move against the flow. The walls here were alive with murals that depicted the might of Atlantis at its zenith, trade with distant lands, the harnessing of energies, and the worship of their deities, beings of water and light. As they journeyed upriver, the murals grew darker, telling a story of cataclysm, a great earthquake, waves that swallowed the earth, and a rain of fire from the skies. The tale of Atlantis's end was laid bare in haunting imagery, a testament to the hubris of a people who had believed their knowledge could defy nature's wrath. After what felt like hours, the boat came to a halt in a dome-like structure where the river spread into a calm, wide pool. The dome was lit by the same glowing crystals they had seen before, and at its center stood an obelisk, inscribed with a message in the flowing script of Atlantis. Morgan approached the obelisk, and as her fingers touched the cold stone, she felt a vibration, a resonance that seemed to echo through the chambers of her own heart. The message was a welcome and a warning, a plea for those who found this place to remember Atlantis not for its end, but for its life, for the pursuit of knowledge and the fleeting brilliance of its existence. Here, the chapter would conclude, but the full version would further describe the emotional and intellectual impact of these discoveries on Morgan and her team. The intricacies of the puzzles and the descriptions of their journey through the underground passages would be expanded upon, as would the careful documentation of their findings, all woven into the backdrop of this most extraordinary discovery. Chapter 3. Whispers of the Ancients. The obelisk's vibration against Morgan's fingertips felt like a heartbeat, a pulse of the ancient city that resonated with the rhythm of tides and time. With the translucence of the water casting an ethereal glow on her team's faces, she could see they all felt the weight of the moment. They stood at the precipice of a discovery that could change history. The team set up their portable workstations around the pool's edge, with the obelisk at the center like a silent overseer. Morgan turned her attention to the inscriptions, the flowing script of the Atlanteans that she had begun to decipher with an intimacy that spoke of nights spent under the soft glow of her desk lamp, surrounded by ancient texts and linguistic puzzles. As she translated, the story that emerged was one of enlightenment and doom. The Atlanteans had reached heights unparalleled, their understanding of nature and science far beyond what the modern world had achieved. Yet, amidst these tales of grandeur, there was a tremor of desperation, a plea for forgiveness and understanding. The obelisk wasn't just a historical record, it was a confession. The chamber around them held more than just the echoes of the past. Panels of crystal, embedded in the walls, seemed to flicker with life as they worked, resonating with the obelisk's hum. The team hypothesized these were part of a complex data storage system, an Atlantean archive of sorts, waiting for the right sequence to be reawakened. Careful not to trigger any latent technology without understanding it, they documented the patterns and symbols, correlating them with the data from the obelisk. The effort was meticulous, each step forward taken with the precision of a chess grandmaster, mindful of the consequences. Nights in the chamber passed, blurring into a continuous thread of discovery and toil. The team had found a rhythm, a routine in this place out of time. Meals were shared in quiet companionship, with conversations often trailing off into thoughtful silence as the weight of their surroundings settled upon them. On what they determined to be the seventh day of their subterranean expedition, a breakthrough occurred. The murals, which had remained static since their arrival, began to shift. Images flowed like liquid across the walls, revealing scenes that moved and breathed with the life of the city in its heyday. The team watched, transfixed, as one mural expanded to show a marketplace teeming with life. Atlanteans of all walks of life mingled, exchanging goods that gleamed with an otherworldly essence. Fish that bore no resemblance to any species recorded in modern times swam in aqueducts, while in the sky, contraptions that defy gravity soared between high towers. Morgan documented the scenes with a fervor that matched her racing heart. This was no mere depiction of everyday life, it was a window into the very soul of Atlantis, a civilization that had harmonized with the world around it to a degree that was almost spiritual. Their focus on the murals was suddenly interrupted by a low hum emanating from the crystals. One by one, they lit up, illuminating the chamber with a brilliance that forced the team to shield their eyes. When they could look again, they saw that the pool's waters had stilled to a perfect mirror, and within its depths, a vision began to coalesce. The image was shaky at first, but soon it stabilized, revealing a council of Atlantean leaders in heated debate. The language barrier was no obstacle, as the emotion transcended the need for words. They were divided, with some advocating for a path of expansion and others warning of the dangers of overreach. The tension was palpable, the stakes high. These visions lasted for hours, providing an unfiltered glimpse into the hearts and minds of a people at the zenith of their existence. They were not gods, but mortals grappling with power and responsibility, a revelation that humanized them beyond the myths. As the visions faded and the waters once again rippled with the gentle currents, the team sat in silence, each lost in contemplation. They had begun to piece together the essence of Atlantis's fall, not a single cataclysm, but a series of events, a slow unraveling of a tapestry woven with threads of ambition and brilliance. The following days were spent correlating the visions with the data from the obelisk and murals. They discovered that the Atlanteans had mastered the manipulation of an energy source that was as volatile as it was potent. This energy, harnessed from the very tectonic forces of the Earth, had been the heart of Atlantis's power and the harbinger of its doom. Morgan realized that the Atlanteans had reached a critical point where their technology had outpaced their wisdom. They had stretched the fabric of their reality too far, and when it snapped back, it took the entire city with it. The discoveries within the chamber provided a sobering lesson, a reminder that all civilizations, no matter how advanced, were subject to the immutable laws of nature. But there was hope, too, a chance to learn from the past, to grasp the torch of enlightenment with a wiser grip. As they prepared to leave the chamber, Morgan felt a twinge of sadness. She had grown to feel a kinship with the Atlanteans, those ancient people whose voices had reached across millennia. They had passed their knowledge and their warning to her, trusting that she would carry it forward. With her backpack secured and her headlamp casting a halo in the darkness, Morgan took one last look at the obelisk. The hum had quieted, and the crystals dimmed, as if the chamber itself was bidding them farewell. She turned away, knowing that the whispers of the ancients would forever echo in her mind, a siren song of discovery and remembrance that she would carry with her back to the surface and into the world. Chapter 4. The Heart of Atlantis. The passage from the Chamber of Visions led deeper into the heart of the subterranean labyrinth, away from the aquatic luminescence and into corridors carved from stone that whispered with the tales of aeons. Morgan's team felt the weight of history upon them, a tangible presence in the cool, stale air that enveloped them as they ventured further into the unknown. Their journey was lit by the soft glow of bioluminescent lichen that adorned the walls in intricate patterns, seemingly leading them forward. The path wound downwards, spiraling into the bowels of the earth, each step a descent into the very womb of Atlantis. Morgan pondered the purpose of such a path. Was it a route of pilgrimage, or a descent into the sanctum of their most sacred knowledge? The walls began to widen, and the air grew warmer, as if the earth itself exhaled a breath kept for millennia. They emerged into a cavern of colossal proportions, where the ceiling was lost to shadows and the ground was covered in a mosaic of tiles that depicted the Tree of Life, its branches reaching out to the edges of the room, its roots delving deep into the floor. At the center of the cavern stood a structure that took their breath away, an orrery of immense complexity, a model of celestial bodies moving in harmonious orbits, driven by an unseen mechanism. With reverent hands, Morgan approached the orrery. Its planets and stars were crafted from a multitude of precious stones, each catching the light and reflecting it in a dance of colors. The craftsmanship was beyond exquisite. It was as if they had captured the very essence of the cosmos and brought it down to Earth. The team set up their equipment, documenting every detail. It quickly became evident that this was not merely a representation of the heavens, it was a machine of purpose. The alignments and movements seemed to correspond with actual celestial events, and the position of certain bodies hinted at a timing mechanism. Could it be that this device was used to predict events both astronomical and terrestrial? As they studied the orrery, its central sphere, a large, opulent crystal, began to emanate a soft light. The air vibrated with energy, and the spheres started to move of their own accord, aligning in a configuration that matched the current positions of the stars and planets in the sky above. The team could only watch in awe as a harmonic tone filled the cavern, a sound that seemed to synchronize with the rhythm of their own heartbeats. It was a music of the spheres. The celestial dance turned into a symphony of sound and light. In this moment, the crystal at the center projected a holographic map of the Earth, pinpointing locations that resonated with the energy lines of the planet, ley lines that the Atlanteans had evidently mapped with precision. The points converged on several locations, ones that Morgan recognized: the pyramids of Giza, Stonehenge, Teotihuacan. The map was a key, a guide to the sacred sites of the world and their connection to Atlantis. This revelation brought a new understanding of the Atlantean legacy. They were not isolated in their grandeur. They had reached out across the globe, influencing and perhaps even establishing the greatest civilizations known to history. Days turned into weeks, and the team meticulously recorded every facet of the Auror's wisdom. Morgan theorized that this knowledge had been shared with select individuals of other cultures, explaining the sudden rise of architectural and astronomical knowledge in ancient civilizations. The pieces of the puzzle were coming together, revealing a tapestry of shared knowledge, a brotherhood of enlightenment that spanned across oceans and continents. Atlantis was not a myth, but a beacon that had illuminated the world, its downfall a tragedy that had sent ripples through time. Morgan knew that this discovery could rewrite history. It would challenge the very foundations of current understanding and, perhaps, invite the modern world to look to the stars once again, to rediscover the wisdom of the ancients. The orbit continued its rotation, a never-ending cycle that mirrored the eternal dance of the universe. As Morgan watched, she felt a connection to those who had come before, the guardians of knowledge who had seen the value in seeking harmony with the cosmos. Before they left the cavern, the team placed a time capsule near the orrery, a record of their own era to be found by future explorers, a link in the unbroken chain of discovery. It was their way of honoring the past and contributing to the future, a whisper into the vast expanse of time. With their data gathered and their mission complete, the team made their way back through the tunnels, ascending toward the surface. The journey back was a contemplation, a silent reverence for the profound truths they had uncovered. When they emerged into the daylight, the world seemed different to them, more intricate, more connected, more alive with the echoes of a timeless wisdom. They had touched the fabric of history and felt its pulse, and in doing so, had changed themselves forever. Morgan looked back one last time at the hidden entrance to the underground realm. With a sense of accomplishment and a heart filled with new purpose, she realized that this was not an end, but a beginning. The mysteries of Atlantis would inspire countless others to seek and to learn, just as it had inspired her. The sun set on the horizon, casting a golden glow over the sea. The chapter of Atlantis was closed, but the book of human endeavor remained open, its pages ready to be filled with the next great adventure of the spirit.